Welcome to Hello English Teacher. Today let's look at the multiple choice questions from the chapter We Are Not Afraid to Die from Class 11 English. If you are watching my video for the first time, please subscribe. You can listen to the explanations of chapters from classes 10, 11 and 12 English. And don't forget to press the bell icon so that you get notified whenever I upload a video. Let's move on to the video now. We Are Not Afraid to Die is written by Gordon Cook and Alan East. So let's look at the extracts from this chapter. Extract number 1. For the longest time, Mary and I, a 37-year-old businessman, had dreamt of sailing in the wake of the famous explorer, and for the past 16 years, we had spent all our leisure time honing our seafaring skills in British waters. So let's see the questions. Question number 1. What has been the writer's dream? To travel around the world by sea, to start a business, to become a famous pilot, to do something unexpected. So here the answer is A, to travel around the world by sea. So now let's look at the next question from this extract. What was the writer's job? Was he a driver, a teacher, a businessman or a singer? So we know that the writer was a businessman. So that was his job. So let's look at the next question. How did the husband and wife get ready to realize their dream? They went to meet the world famous explorer. They were practicing their seafaring skills for the past 16 years. They made a boat of their own. They read a lot about voyages. So the answer is B. They were practicing their seafaring skills for the past 16 years. So that is what helped them to realize their dream. So who is the world famous explorer they wanted to imitate? Was it Captain James Cook, Vasco da Gama, Marco Polo or Ferdinand Magellan? So the answer is A, Captain James Cook. So the next extract. The first leg of our planned 3-year, 105,000 kilometer journey passed pleasantly as we sailed down the west coast of Africa to Cape Town. There before heading east, we took on 2 crewmen, American Larry Vigil and Swiss Herb Siegler, to help us tackle one of the world's roughest seas, the Southern Indian Ocean. So in question number 1, how much distance did they cover in their first leg? So here the answer is 105,000 kilometers, which was covered in their first leg. So next question, what was completed in a pleasant manner? The first leg of journey to Cape Town from Africa, the journey from Africa to Australia, their journey in the second leg, journey from Cape Town to England. So here the answer is A, the first leg of journey from Africa to Cape Town. So let's look at the next question from this extract. Why do you think they took crewmen aboard their ship? They wanted someone who knew the way around. They wanted help to tackle the roughest seas ahead. They wanted crewmen for company. The crewmen too had ambitious voyage dreams. So here the answer is B. They wanted help to tackle the roughest seas ahead, which is the Indian Ocean. What is considered as one of the roughest seas in the world? The Indian Ocean, the Southern Indian Ocean, the Pacific Ocean, the Atlantic Ocean. So the Southern Indian Ocean is considered one of the roughest seas in the world. So that is why they wanted crewmen for help. So let's look at the next extract. The first indication of impending disaster came at about 6 p.m. with an ominous silence. The wind dropped and the sky immediately grew dark. Then came a growing roar and an enormous cloud towered off the ship. With horror, I realized that it was not a cloud, but a wave like no other I had ever seen. It appeared perfectly vertical and almost twice the height of the other waves, with a frightful breaking crest. So let's look at the questions. Question number 1. What was the indication of the impending disaster that was going to strike the boat? A terrible wind, storm in the sea, an ominous silence or heavy rain? So here the answer is an ominous silence that indicated some impending disaster. So next question, what were the changes in the weather? There was no wind. The sky grew dark and a huge wave towered on the boat. There was heavy rain and a huge cloud stood on top of the boat. Storm in the sea toppled the boat. Violent storm and heavy rain in the sea. So the answer is A. There was no wind. The sky grew dark and a huge wave towered on the boat. So next question. Describe the wave that struck the boat. It was horizontal and covered the entire boat. It was perfectly vertical and twice the other waves, and had a frightful breaking crest. The wave was like the normal rough waves in the ocean. The wave was vertical and frightful. So the answer is B. It was a perfectly vertical and twice the other waves and had a frightful breaking crest. So let's look at the next question. What is meant by ominous silence? A hidden danger, some danger that is going to happen, an unpleasant and threatening silence, a pleasant surprise. So here the answer is C, an unpleasant and threatening silence. So that is what ominous silence means. So let's look at the next extract. Water, water everywhere. I could feel that the ship had water below, but I dare not abandon the wheel to investigate. Suddenly, the front hatch was thrown open and Mary appeared. We are sinking, she screamed. The decks are smashed. We are full of water. Take the wheel, I shouted as I scrambled for the hatch. So let's look at the questions from this extract. What was filled with water everywhere? The wave walker, the ocean, the captain's boat, the captain's cabin or cabins in the boat. So here the answer is A. The wave walker, which is their ship, it was filled with water everywhere because of this storm in the sea. So next question. Why did the writer not want to abandon the wheel and investigate? He knew that the dangerous situation has ceased. He felt that it could put the boat in more trouble. He was not willing to investigate. He was sure that nothing had happened to the boat. So the answer is B. He felt that it could put the boat in more trouble if he leave the wheel and start to investigate. So the next question. Why did the writer's wife Mary scream? She heard the loud noise of the wave striking the wave walker. The deck was smashed and all the cabins were full of water. She did not know what was happening in the boat. She cried out of anxiety. So here the answer is B. The deck was smashed and all the cabins were full of water. So that is why she cried. So next question. What did the writer ask his wife to do? To keep quiet, to keep the children safe, to take the wheel, to not bother about what is happening. So the answer is C. He asked his wife to take the wheel. So let's look at the next extract. The night dragged on with an endless, bitterly cold routine of pumping, steering and working on the radio. We were getting no replies to our mayday calls, which was not surprising in the remote corner of the world. Sue's head had swollen alarmingly. She had two enormous black eyes and now she showed us a deep cut on her arm. So let's look at the questions from this extract. Question number one. How did they spend the night? Sleeping peacefully, sleeping with occasional storm and rains, pumping out water, steering and working on the radio, looking out for more dangerous waves. So the answer is C, pumping out water, steering and working on the radio. So question number two, what do you think is a mayday call? So calling someone to inquire about mayday, distress call that is used to signal a life-threatening emergency, or calling the police for assistance, or calling family or relatives for aid. So the answer is B, distress call that is used to signal a life-threatening emergency. So let's look at the next question. What was not surprising to the author? No one answering their mayday calls, somebody answering their distress calls, their condition in the middle of the sea, the behavior of the children during the storm. So the answer is A, no one answering their mayday calls was not surprising to the author. So next question, who is Sue? The author's wife, the author's daughter, one of the crewmen, the author's friend. So Sue is the author's daughter. So let's look at the next extract. I checked our charts and calculated that there were two small islands a few hundred kilometers to the east. One of them, Isle Amsterdam, was a French scientific base. Our only hope was to reach these pinpricks in the vast ocean. But unless the wind and the seas abated so we could hoist sail, our chances would be slim indeed. So let's look at the questions from this extract. Question number one, what was the result of the author's calculation? Nothing appeared in front of the boat. Two little islands could be reached within a few kilometers. Australia is very close to them. England is about 1,000 kilometers from them. So after the calculations here, what they found out is they could reach two little islands that could be reached, which were within a few kilometers. So the answer is B. So the next question, what is Isle Amsterdam? A solitary island in the ocean, a British scientific base, a French scientific base, or a busy city in England? So Isle Amsterdam is nothing but C, a French scientific base. So the next question, what do you mean by pinpricks in the vast ocean? Large islands not easily visible, tiny islands not easily visible, southernmost tip of South Africa with a lot of islands, huge land masses not inhabited by people. So the answer is B, tiny islands that are not visible to human eye. So that is pinpricks in the vast ocean. So next question, why is the chance to reach these islands very slim? There was no wind and storm in the sea. The boat was nearly broken to bits. The weather continued to be rough. The author and his team was completely tired. So the answer is the weather continued to be rough. So that is why the chances were slim to reach these islands. That is a tiny pinpricks in the vast ocean. So let's look at the next extract. At that moment, a tousled head appeared by my bunk. Can I have a hug? Jonathan asked. Sue was right behind him. Why am I getting a hug now? I asked. Because you are the best daddy in the whole world and the best captain, my son replied. So let's look at the questions. Who was the tousled head that appeared? The writer, Jonathan, Larry, or Sue? So it was Jonathan, his son, who appeared in front of him. So next question, what did Jonathan ask his father? To give him a hug, to take him back home, to allow him to take the wheel, to take him to a doctor. So the answer is A, to give him a hug. So next question, why did Jonathan want to hug his father? He was very sad about his injuries. He felt that his father was the best dad in the world. His father had taken care of Jonathan very well. He wanted to please his father. So the answer is B, he felt that his father was the best dad in the world. So that is why he wanted to hug his father. So let's look at the next question. Why did Jonathan exclaim that his father was the best daddy and the best captain in the world? Because he found the island that was only a pinprick in the ocean. Because his father repaired the boat on time. Because his father did not give up hope. Because his father wanted Jonathan's support. So the answer is A, because he found the island that was only a pinprick in the vast ocean. So that's all for this video. I hope you like this video. For more informative videos, do subscribe to Hello English Teacher. Like, share, and give your valuable comments below. Thank you for watching.